Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resident Arcade. It's Wednesday night, and we are live.
Good evening.
As you can see, there's only Sam with me today. And in fact, I just realised I've set Sam up slightly wrong. He's still got some of the Skype controls underneath your head. But anyway, doesn't matter. Not the end of the world, does it? Enhances your image, I think.
Yeah, that's more colour.
To those of you who have seen us before, you know what we're all about. We're just a couple of guys that do put a gaming podcast once every few weeks. It has been less regular than normal recently. We lost a team member and we decided also to cut it down a little bit. But we're back. We've had a couple of weeks off this time round, mainly because I've been uber busy and I haven't been kicking everyone in the arse to get into gear every week. But we're here. So traditionally, we said there's only two of us today, so hopefully we'll be able to keep the flow going. But traditionally, we start talking about games that we've played over the last, I think it's 3 weeks, isn't it?
Yeah, 3 weeks. So well, you've got a much bigger list than I have, so I could either rattle through mine quickly, or you could have a big go of yours.
A couple of weeks ago, let's just do one, just one each. A couple of weeks ago, I went to a LAN party with Steve and Lou, Lou being a previous host and Steve being a current host who's currently working tonight, and a couple of our other friends as well. We played quite a lot of different games, mostly obviously multiplayer games. There's a few that we've talked about before, but there's also a few that are pretty new. But I'm going to just go through the ones that I found particularly interesting or we played quite a lot of. So first of all, a game you will probably have heard me talk about before is a brawler called Gang Beasts. Now, I saw this first at a tech demo in, well, not a tech demo, it was actually a gameplay demo on the Xbox 360, an indie event a good while ago, and all it is a brawler. You run around and there's these little Play-Doh men, and apparently the devs initially intended to make it a single player kind of walking through the streets and, you know, kicking the hell out of gangs and stuff, hence why it's called Gang Beasts.
Final Fight type thing.
Yeah, but it ended up being an arena brawler. And it's actually a lot of fun. The way that they put it together is... there's a nice little bug there for you. The way that they put it together was they created a ragdoll for each of the characters, and then they assigned the two limbs to the paddle buttons on your Xbox controller. So if you press your left controller, it punches left, right paddle, it punches right. But you can also do context sensitive things. So if you hold Y down on your Xbox controller, he holds his hands up in the air. If you hold Y down, you have to hold some of the paddles down as well. So the control system is quite unique. You hold the paddles down and he holds his hands up in the air so that you can do some little silly gestures. But because it's all ragdoll stuff, it's all ragdoll physics, it just creates some ridiculous and really funny moments. One thing you can do is, like, for example, you hold down both the paddles, press Y, and you hold people up in the air, and you're supposed to just throw them off buildings, throw them out of a ring, throw them in front of trains, like this, for example.
Pissed. It looks like two drunk hobos fighting on a subway. One of whom happens to be wearing a cape.
The premise is pretty daft. The devs have updated it a lot since last time I played it. In fact, last time I played it, I couldn't even load the game. The controller support wasn't working. But now there's a fair amount in there. It's actually a lot of fun, and we spent a lot of time playing it. And it's up to 4 or 8 players, I think, you can play. So we had 4 controllers plugged into my PC, all playing it together on the same screen. And as per, like, Nidhogg or something like that, which is another game we played a little bit of, it's a lot of fun, and it's definitely worth a go. If you fancy a single screen, bit of fun with your mates and a lot of laughs, in fact, because I mean, just getting it by a train and flying off into the distance is funny enough. But there's lots of different levels. There's like a carousel wheel that you can kind of grab onto and turn around. There's this level here is it's a fan, so the fans blow up or suck you down as well, so you have to time your... And there's also fans on the side that suck you into them as well. So you have to time your kind of punches and everything. There's a lot of luck involved in it as well. It's a bit of a...
I have seen footage of it before, but this is more advanced than what I originally saw. It was much more It was much more basic, I think, when I saw it before. I'm guessing they've added to it over time. It's been out for a while, this, hasn't it? Or it's been available like in early access, perhaps, or something like that.
It's still in early access, I think. It's still not a complete game, but you know what indie devs like. Quite often games get left and in a pre-release state and never really get updated. But it's funny, it's good. I mean, you can like headbutt as well, and you can do like running jump kicks at people as well. But yeah, it's just a lot of guesswork in it, you know. But it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of good fun. So apart from that, at the LAN, the other things we played quite a lot of. We played quite a lot of Killing Floor 2. And I don't suppose you've heard of Killing Floor 1, have you?
I feel like that's another one that's been brought up on the show, but you'd have to remind me which one it is.
So, to my mind, Killing Floor is a horde game. It's a zombie horde game. And again, this is a YouTube video from some guys called... Anyway, I'll put it in the patch notes underneath. But essentially, it's a shooter, and just tons and tons of zombies come at you in waves, and you're supposed to upgrade your character or upgrade your classes up to like level 20 or 25, I think it is. And every time you upgrade them, like the typical kind of COD style gameplay, COD Battlefront type thing, you get a new perk of some sort and you have to upgrade your character in a certain way. But I mean it's good, it's well put together. The first game was a bit buggy, you know, it was a little bit it was for a core set of fans, you know, it didn't appeal to the masses. This is a lot more popular and it's a lot more refined. It uses the Unreal Engine and it's quite a nice game, but not my type of thing these days. It's a little bit mindless, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, it's the kind of game, it's a bit like the Call of Duty Zombies mode, which is fun if you've got a few people there and maybe there's a few beers involved.
Yeah.
But it has no longevity to it. And I think after a couple of sessions, you probably had enough, really.
I mean, I did, but I mean, one guy at the LAN in particular has been playing it day in, day out for years, and he loves it.
Not Lou.
Lou enjoys it as well. It's not a criticism of any type of gamer. It's just not my kind of game, you know? It is very nice looking. It does require quite a lot of skill in order to get quite good at it, but it's also just the same thing over and over and over. Every single match, you play a different map, but you play up to 10 waves, I think it is, and you can play short games, like 3 waves or 5 waves, I think, and basically the last wave is the boss, and the boss is the same every time, and the enemies are all the same. There's normal zombies, there's like little spider things, there's skreks. Skreks are that thing I think he just killed, in fact. I'm not entirely sure, to be fair. I'll probably be embarrassing myself if I go through them all, but there's maybe about 10, 15 different types of enemies, and that's it, though. And it's, you know, there's an upgrade system and path, as you can see here. It's very Counter-Strike-like in terms of the way that the buying mechanism works. You, in between each round, or in between each wave, you have to make your way to a merchant, and then the merchant sells you things based on how much essential experience you've got through that round. But you can also share money between people as well. So say that guy who's been playing forever, he used to get quite a lot of money, so he'd always give his money away to other people after he'd finished the round and done, you know, what he needed to buy. You have to buy ammo in between rounds as well, and if you shit at the game, you just don't get very far, you know.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah, not my kind of thing, but you know, I can appreciate how it would appeal to others. So we played quite a lot of that. We also played quite a lot of Chivalry Modern Warfare.
Have you heard of that? I know about Chivalry, but I didn't know they'd done a Modern Warfare one. So what do you treat people now?
Sorry,
instead?
Not modern. I always call it Modern Warfare. Sorry, Chivalry Medieval Warfare. What?
I thought Chivalry. So is this a different game from Ordinary Chivalry, or was that Chivalry's full title originally?
Well, what was Chivalry that you knew?
Where you're running around with swords and armor and fighting each other.
Yeah, it's the same game. Yeah, essentially, it's been upgraded quite a lot. and it looks a lot nicer than it used to, and it also plays a lot nicer than it used to. And this is quite a while ago now. It's quite an old game, but they've recently refreshed it, and it's just nice to play. The combat system, I really love as a bit of fun. It's not something that I would go off and play on my own, I don't think, but as a bit of fun at a LAN party, I actually really like it. It's daft, you know. I mean, you've got about 6 buttons for screaming at people, you know, just different taunts and stuff that you can do. But
do you have a selection of voices to choose from to screaming?
I think so. I mean, I'm not entirely sure. There is an upgrade system with it as well. I don't think there's any kind of buy upgrades or anything like that, like you can do in, I think in Killing Floor 2 you can buy upgrades. But again, every game, I think you keep the same characters, so you, like, again, more like a Battlefront, more like a COD type thing. You keep the same characters, and each class has an experience system. So the more you play with each class, the more unlocks you get, and the more kind of different types of weapons. You've always got like a throwable weapon, which is either like a smoke bomb or a grenade of some sort, or throwing knives or throwing axes, and they're just a lot, again, just daft and a lot of fun to play with. It's also one of them games where I can play it and play it and play it, and then one game I'll be the best on the map and I'll kick everyone's ass, and then other games I'll be absolutely awful and not get any points. You know, you kind of, if you're on a downward streak, you kind of stay on a downward streak, I've found. They also did another version of it, which is Deadliest Warrior, which has a ninja in it, and the samurai. There's also a pirate in there.
Is that to do with the Deadliest Warrior TV show, where they pick different people from history and say, who would win between a Spartan and a ninja?
Maybe. I've not seen Deadliest Warrior, but I'd heard of it. I didn't know
I think that's the basic premise. I could be wrong, but I believe that's it. It's just silly, isn't it? But yeah. So they put that into it as well. So there's different... Does that mean there's different fighting styles then, if you have different...
Yeah. Like, the ninja's a bit faster. There's guys that are better at throwing, like the samurai guy is obviously better with a katana sword, and the pirate guy's got a rapier. The same with chivalry, though. Chivalry, all the different classes, and all even the different weapons within the different classes have slightly different moves, and they have slightly different ways of lengths of weapon. So if you've got a halberd or something like that, halberd's really long, and or a pike or something like that, you can attack people from a distance, but it's two-handed, so you can't have a shield. You know, if you've got a shield and a short sword, you're going to have to be up close and personal. So a guy with a halberd's probably going to knack you before you get anywhere. But then again, they're a little bit slower at attacking you, so it's a trade-off again. Deadliest Warrior will be the same. Didn't play any of it, unfortunately, so I can't really comment on it. But I played some on my own, and I played the tutorial just to have a go of it. In terms of the LAN party, there's loads of other games. We played Nidhogg and that kind of thing, but... That was the kind of what the main things that we played there. Oh, we played a bit of Minecraft as well, just for a laugh.
Together?
Just me and Lou for a little bit, but I don't think anyone else was particularly interested in it.
I don't really get how multiplayer Minecraft works. Is it just that you can cooperate and do some stuff to build something together? Is that basically the idea?
There's a few different modes. I mean, I quite like survival mode, which is just you get plunked in the middle of nowhere and you have to build a house by night, otherwise you get killed by zombies and creepers and skeletons and endermen. Or you... I think there's adventure mode, which I'm not sure how it works. I might be thinking of Dwarf Fortress there. There's a few different modes, and I can't remember off the top of my head them, but survival's the best for me, because you just essentially have to build a shelter, mine for things, and kind of build up a little house, and it's just cool building a little house. I don't know something about it. It could be fairly creative. Oh, there's creative mode as well, which is just you get given everything, an infinite supply of everything. You can fly around as well, and you just essentially build a world. It doesn't appeal to me, but I can totally see it appealing to people who just want to build.
Yeah, I imagine those are the ones where people have built like Minas Tirith and stuff, you know, That'll be in that mode, I imagine.
I've watched a few.
If you're going to build something that big, you can't be getting attacked by zombies at night every time, can you?
Well, that, and if you need to build something that big, you also need to fly as well and cheat, essentially, which you can't do in the normal game because you need to, you know, you need to build all kinds of stuff. But I've seen a few Twitch streams where there've just been guys just building. I saw this guy build a massive pirate ship, and you know, it is quite cool.
Apparently, it's really popular among kids, isn't it? Apparently, it's.
Oh, it's massive. It's the biggest game in the world.
Yeah, but it's a game almost more for the creative stuff than for the actual game as a game, if you know what I mean.
The survival mode is quite scary as well in its own way. If you go into a cave, you can open up a massive chasm, and if you're not prepared for it, then you can easily get killed within seconds because wherever there's darkness, absolute darkness, an enemy can spawn. So you tend to, once you've opened a cave up, you tend to run around the cave and try and find every bit of darkness and light it up as quickly as you can. And if you don't do that, you can't really build or mine in that cave. So, and there's always little ambient noises as well. Even if there's nothing there, there's a little ambient noise that's always got you on your guard. It's quite, you know, simple things, but it's quite cleverly put together. Anyway, I've waited on about some of my games. So go on then, give us what you've been playing.
Well, we talked about this last time, and I think obviously Steve's not here to account for himself, but we all discussed an interest in The Witness, and I went and downloaded it. And I have since played it to, I guess you could say I got to the end, but I will say one thing, there's more than one ending, I think. It's such a strange game to talk about because anybody that looks at any game footage of it, if you've seen one puzzle in The Witness, you've kind of seen them all, but that doesn't go anywhere near into how complex and challenging these puzzles become. The game is basically, it's a game where you basically wander around an island with very little story setup. You literally get plonked on this island and you approach these panels where you basically have to get a line from a sort of circular thing on a panel, and then feed the line to an outlet of the panel in one continuous line. And you have to do that for every single puzzle. That's how all of them work. Now, sometimes you have to go through certain dots that are in the panel's shape. So, for example, this one here, you have to thread it through those yellow dots that it's showing you there.
Okay.
To get to the end. And then from there, it just gets ever more complex. Like this one, you've got to separate the black tiles from the white tiles. And then it goes on and on and on, and it gets more and more complicated as it goes. And it gets to levels where you feel like you've got it right, and you haven't, and you don't really know why.
Right.
So overall, I'm going to say that I did like the game in a lot of ways, but I found it massively frustrating and annoying, probably more time than I spent enjoying it.
Really?
That could just be to do with me, though, and how I am with certain kinds of puzzle games. I felt like sometimes when I was learning a new mechanic, a new rule, shall I say, for doing the panels, I felt like I got something. You can get things right when you first try out a new mechanic and not know why, and then you have to go back and get it right because the next panel will not let you off, but you don't know what you did right sometimes, and the game doesn't help you in any way with any of that sort of stuff. And I've heard this from a few different people, but some people have absolutely adored it because it their brain works that way, whereas some of the design and some of the ways that you have to complete the puzzles I thought were ingenious. I really did. I thought they were really impressive, and to go from, you know, nothing to that and to have these panels that are so complex and the way that they can sometimes interact with the world and open up areas for you, I thought it was really clever, but sometimes it just made me really angry, and it made me feel stupid as well. Like, it made me feel like, why can't I do this? Which I had moments as well in games like Portal. And this is one of those games that I think people that like Portal are going to be interested in because it has...
I didn't feel that with Portal. I thought that everything was quite cleverly done, and it wasn't hand-holdy either. It wasn't...
Yeah, I was going to say, I think Portal did a better job of executing that idea than this game did, personally.
Right.
I feel like there's a lot of things in the game. A lot. I don't want to have my hand held, but I feel that the way you introduced the mechanics in Portal felt like I understood what I was doing before I got challenged. Whereas in this game, you sometimes don't really understand what the mechanic is, or I didn't sometimes. And then you were challenged quite harshly with something that you didn't really know what you were doing with, or you didn't really know the full extent of what you were doing. And there's also another element to take into account, is that as much as the game, when you're walking around, it has a really lovely aesthetic design quality to it. Some of the colours and the sort of design of the overall world is beautiful, but the fact of the matter remains, all of your puzzle solving is looking at a square panel that you could literally do on a piece of paper. Every single puzzle pretty much comes down to that. There are a couple of environmental things, which I won't spoil, that you, as if you play it, you'll figure out there's a couple of environmental things that you can do, but you know, 90% of the puzzles that you're doing in the game is feeding a white line on a flat panel that you could do on a piece of paper. And that's kind of a problem for a video game, in my opinion.
What's the point in the rest of the environment then?
Yeah, a little bit. There's a touch of that feel to it. The environment is almost there to sort of look nice for its own sake. The game has gotten some extremely high reviews, and it could be that I've been softened up and not played as many puzzle games as I have action games. If I was like a hardcore puzzle gamer, maybe I would have got into the mindset a bit more. But there's a couple of times when I got really frustrated with solutions, and I confess I looked up a couple of solutions online because I was like, I just don't see how I can possibly do this. I don't see what I'm doing wrong, and I don't know what to do right at all.
Right.
In a few instances. But there were occasional things. There's a couple of puzzles that involve sound, which I thought were really clever, and that really clicked with me because I understood it straight away, what I was supposed to do and how it worked. And even when it got difficult, the sound ones, I still knew, I had a basic grasp of what the intentions were, that I could get around it. Whereas there were some of them that I just felt a bit clueless. So it's an interesting game. It's a game, actually, I would definitely recommend everyone to try and see what you think, rather than say, this game might necessarily be for me. I'm glad that I had a go at it, for example. I'm glad that I gave it a go, because there are some moments that are quite satisfying when you get a mechanic right and you know how a puzzle works. It feels quite good. But there are some times when it made me feel thick, and it made me feel angry and annoyed at the game and myself. I would turn it off.
I think there are some moments like that in Talos Principle as well, but I didn't get too stuck with any of the tasks. The only time that I ever looked anything up is like some of the optional stuff. There's a few puzzles that you have to use puzzles or parts of puzzles that are already within the game in order to get things like some of the gold stars. I think I maybe looked two or three of them up in all. There's loads of Easter eggs as well, though, but I'm the kind of person who likes to find every little bit of content in a game if I can.
Yes.
Not necessarily to get my money's worth. I just feel like I haven't really got everything out of the game until I've done that, if you know what I mean. I don't know if I'm going to like it. It sounds like it may, I don't know. It depends, I think, maybe the mood I'm in when I play it.
Yeah, it almost might be worth possibly waiting in. I don't know how much it is on Steam. It's probably less than it is that I played for it on the PlayStation Network.
Yeah, I'm not sure. I haven't looked at it in any detail yet.
I didn't feel that I was overcharged particularly for what I got, and I put quite a fair few hours into it, and there were some that I really enjoyed. There were some puzzles that I really enjoyed, but it could just be because I clicked with what they were getting at, maybe, and some of them, and sometimes I didn't with others, and I can't really explain why that is. Again, it's got a lovely aesthetic design to the world, but the world is kind of a little bit superfluous to the core puzzle mechanics of the game, whereas I don't want to keep going back to Portal, but Portal did this stuff really well. And I know that they have the might of Valve behind them and all that stuff going on, but it's the things in Portal, the little details in Portal that make it work so well, particularly in Portal 2. As you are getting closer to the solution of the puzzle, they decide to up the music. The music gets louder, he gets a bit more dancey or whatever, as you get better and you're like, ah, I'm on the right track now. There isn't any feedback like that in this game. There's no music at all, actually, apart from in really small sections. There's the lack of ambient noise and a feeling of slight lifelessness as well to the world, even though it's pretty, really, really pretty to look at. There's just a slight sort of deadness. There's a slight, I can't remember what the word I'm looking for is. It's just, it just feels like you're walking through a painting with no life in it, really. There's no animals. There are no living things anywhere. And that could be the point. Maybe it's part of what the game is about. But I felt like a little bit of background music, a little bit of ambience, a little bit of more characterization in these little things on the island would have helped me enjoy the experience of being there more. Even though visually it was pretty much spot on. It's a lovely, beautiful, I would say, looking game. Very, very nicely designed world. And the panels themselves are quite nicely designed, apart from there's a few colour ones with sort of clashing and contrasting colours, which depending on how you react to that sort of stuff can make you feel a bit weird after a while.
Okay. Especially if you're staring at it for a long time. And
yes, staring at sort of colours that are flashing and changing made me feel a bit weird, and I didn't like it, and it put me off.
I have a problem with websites that have, and this doesn't matter what monitor I look at them on, that have a dark background with light text. I have a real problem with that. I can't look, when I look away, my eyes are affected for quite a while, and I imagine some of the puzzles are like that.
There's a little bit of that in there. I kind of want to say that I recommend it, but at the same time, not that much. I recommend giving it a go, or maybe you don't want to spoil it too much for yourself. Maybe having a look at a couple of gameplay videos and seeing if after maybe the first couple of major puzzles, it seems like the kind of thing you'd want to go into. It's an intriguing game. I never played Braid, and I heard that Braid towards the end got very difficult as well.
I wouldn't say. I mean, to me, Braid got a little bit arbitrary. Some of the puzzles were just a little bit like, I understand how to do this puzzle, but I can't be arsed because it's too much rework, if you know what I mean. It's too much trying over and over and over until you get the exact right combination of key presses. It's like mastering a Super Mario level and getting every single coin and doing it as fast as you possibly can. That's what it felt a little bit like. And there's no joy in that. Other people, yes, I imagine there would be, but there's no joy in being exact in a game, if that makes sense. I like freedom. I like the fact that, again, let's go back to the Talos Principle or Portal, that you don't have to be exact with solving quite a lot of the puzzles. You basically, you know, you can just little daft things like not quite having a companion cube on the right, fully on a pressure plate, you know, you don't have to put it exact. There's dynamics involved in the world, and I like that in games, and I don't like having to do something exactly right. I'm sure there's an example of a game where I have to do things exactly right that I really enjoy, but you know what I mean.
Yeah,
I don't know where
I think based on that you might not enjoy it that much. I mean, I don't think I'll probably go back and play it again now that I've played it once. Even though there are more extra secret things that I found out since that I can go and like unlock and try out. But the thing is, all you're unlocking is more puzzles to complete. That's the thing. You're not unlocking like apparently there is like a secret ending you can get, which I've not got myself. But you can't find the Ratman's nest and stuff like you can in Portal 2, which gives you a little bit of lore and background to the world. You're just finding some more frustrating puzzles to complete. Yeah. And another thing that, again, with the sound design, that my sister came in and sort of saw me playing on it. And when you start a panel, you click on there's always like a rounded area, which is where you always start. Sometimes you have a few options, but you have to start there. And as soon as you do it, as the white line is like on, there's like a noise. And it's there until you complete the puzzle. So if you're sitting there thinking about it and pulling it back, that noise is there the whole time. And Lucy was like, is that noise not like annoying to you? And I was like, yeah, it kind of is, but I got used to it after a while, yeah. Which is a bit of a problem as well. It's like I had to get used to this noise because there's no music there. So sometimes you'd be in complete silence with this noise and you try to figure out an annoying puzzle and you've got this sort of like fairly high-pitched noise. And when it clicked, it was, that's cool. That sort of feels nice. But sometimes you have to go through like minutes of threading a thing through this way. No, it doesn't work. I'll pull it back. I'll start again, go this way. No, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
And you can be there for minutes and minutes at a time on one panel. Well,
I'm definitely still going to give it a go. You know what I'm like with my sales anyway. It'll probably be in a bundle at some point and I'll probably get it in one of them. But I've got about 10 to 20 other games I want to get through soon that are piling up. I mean, I've still got Arkham Knight to play, for example, and I really, really want to play that now. It's in my favourite list ready to go, but
I would definitely give this one like a, yeah, play it possibly on the cheap, because if you love it, then hey, you got it cheap, and then you discovered this thing that you really like. If it frustrates you and you don't really dig it, then it's not a big loss to your wallet.
Well, that's my philosophy with most games, because you don't know what you're getting. You really don't know what you're getting until you've played it. I mean, I skipped Far Cry 4 entirely. But I really do want to play Far Cry Primal, but I know I'm going to get it and I'm going to be like, right, so this is Far Cry 3 with dinosaurs.
Speaking of that game, a couple of lads I know at work have got it and said it's okay, but it's just Far Cry without guns.
Is it out now?
Yeah, it's been out for a while. Apparently it's not that interesting. It's okay.
Okay, so moving on to another game. I'll do one and then you can do one. Okay, so I've been doing quite a lot of train journeys recently. I've been working away. So I've had quite a few hours each week to play around with things. When I haven't been doing bits of work, I've been playing a game called Starbound, which I definitely have mentioned before. Now, Starbound... Oh. Sorry, we've got sound on that. I didn't mean that to happen. Starbound is an other Terraria type game. However, it's got a slight difference in that you're in space and you can travel between lots of different planets. And the main single player quest is essentially, so far anyway, it seems to be you have to repair your ship so you can start traveling further afield. And you have to gather fuel for your ship so you can move to different clusters and that kind of thing. It's all randomly generated. Every planet is slightly different. I've played it quite a few times through. I started all over again this time because last time I played it, there was a point I just couldn't get past in the main mission. There was nothing available for me to get past it. But now it seems to be fairly fully featured. I'm sure they're still working on bits. So when you're on a planet, you can build a little city, or you can, you know, you can now have people living in your little houses. You can grow crops. You can, you know, it's a typical kind of what do they call them these days? The Terrarias and the Mine survival type game.
Okay.
But there's something I really like about this that makes me keep going back to it, and it's still in beta, or it's still in early access rather, but they do keep updating it and keep giving new things to it, and I really like the way it works as well, because the combat seems to be quite it's quite interesting, and there's a lot of different types of weapons. Like, for example, there I've got a Shakram and I've also got a pistol, but on my other game, on my laptop, I've been playing with a bazooka and a flamethrower. You know, there's tons of different combinations of items. You can also upgrade yourself. You can have like double jumps and dashes, and they're called tech upgrades in the game. And you can also upgrade your ship, which I haven't quite got to yet. And there's also vehicles too, but I haven't, again, opened them this way around. I don't even know if they're accessible yet. I think there's going to be quite a lot more to it, and I'm going to keep playing it. But all of this that you can see here, I've built so far. I've been faffing around with it and, you know, tweaking things. It's actually an old ruin, this, that I've took over and started building.
But it seems to be going for that sort of like space cowboy type well, aesthetic as well.
It does, yeah, now at the moment. I mean, previously the cowboy thing didn't really seem to exist, but now this is actually Iron Armor, and you've got, I think it's a, you start off with outlaw stuff, then you go into a sheriff stuff, and it's all like, it's like building, you know, like in Skyrim, you have the different tiers of armor, such as glass, iron, Daedric, and that kind of thing. It has that kind of theme to it, and you in order to do some quests, you have to have certain types of armors. I mean, I can definitely sit and criticize it all day, but I really do like it, and the last time I found it that I kind of ran out of things to do, it kind of felt a little bit samey, but it seems like they've got quite a lot of variation in the planets now as well, and they've got there's lots of little daft settlements and stuff in the game. There seems to be as well, they've introduced like submissions or kind of random missions, so you can be running around in a planet and suddenly find a teleporter, and that teleporter will take you to a special area that you have to go through, and it's just kind of platform puzzle type thing. And then once you've completed the platform puzzle, you get a chest full of cool rare items or epic items or something. There's also outposts in different systems, and the outposts have loads of NPCs in them, so it's like a space station type thing, and they will give you quests, and some of them will be dead simple little quests like craft me a shirt or something, you know, but others will be more complicated, like this might, like for one of the main quest items seems to be, I've just done it actually in both my saves, you have to go and help a mining facility that's been taken over by some alien thing, and it's just like a simple puzzle at the end. You have to switch four switches three times and fire something out of this kind of big crystal thing. But it seems to have a lot more in it than it used to. Starbound as well in the indie games community has been it's been kind of hyped up quite a lot over the years. And it's been out for quite a while now, so the hype died down definitely, but it's still getting content added to it, and it seems to be a lot more stable than it ever was as well.
How long has it been out? How long are we talking?
I'm not entirely sure. Years.
Okay.
But it's been through many incarnations and many patch up, like major patch updates as well. It's not out yet, but it is. It was released on December the 4th, 2013, early access apparently. So it's not that old, but 3 years, that's still a long time to be in early access. It's got a really nice soundtrack as well. It's kind of got that kind of Minecraft and Terraria kind of feel to it. I think it's full orchestral as well. But you can also pick up like musical instruments in the game and play for release on a piano and little daft things like that. There's a multiplayer aspect, which I've never played. I was hoping at some point to maybe have a go of it, but I haven't built up the courage to go on some public areas yet, if there are any. But I don't know, I think there might be a bit more to the planet exploration now, possibly. Some people have been playing it for, you know, a lot longer than I have, and I've put probably about 100 hours into it.
Yeah. Is it by the same people that made Terraria?
No, it's this is the outpost here. So it's by a company called Chucklefish. And a guy called Finn Bryce wrote it originally, or was the main director of the game. But yeah, I think there's more to it now. I haven't really been following the development, so I don't know what's upcoming, and I don't know what has been released since I last played it. The outpost is definitely more fully featured than it was when I first did it. But there's an outpost in every system as well, so I'm hoping that they're all slightly different. I imagine there's going to be some... I've played two or three games since I started playing it again so far, and the main mission is definitely the same, you know. They've not updated it, it's not randomized like the rest of the game, but the world is procedurally generated, and there's lots of different races to pick from, and there's lots of different drops and weapons and block types and that kind of thing, so it does offer a lot though. I think it's definitely value for money in my eyes. I got it for free anyway. Someone gave it to me. Someone gifted me it. But I do like it. I do like it.
It's a nice looking game. It looks like it's got a lot of stuff going on just from that with the little video that was played there. As in lots of sort of item management and things like that.
Yeah, I mean, this is... I'll turn it back on. This is one of the missions. This is the mining facility. So there's obviously quite a lot of combat involved in this. On the planets themselves, this tends to be... You'll have maybe two or three different types of enemies on a single planet. So far, they seem to be fairly repeating. But previously when I played it, I did do quite a lot of planet exploration in different galaxies. Because previously all you needed was coal to power your spaceship, and coal's abundant on every planet. But now you have to get these this special liquid or plutonium rods and stuff to, which is more realistic, you know.
Yeah, coal-powered spaceships, that's the way forward.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, you can't do that anymore, I don't think. I haven't tried it, but I don't think you can. But yeah, so this is one of the missions, so it's a bit more interesting, you know. It's a bit more than just running around on a planet. But there's lots of different types of planets as well. There's like moons that are airless. They've got airless atmospheres. You've got eccentric star systems, which are rich in titanium or platinum, one of the two. That's all I've discovered so far, but I'm hoping there's more. As I said, I've not been playing the new games for as long as I have previously, so we'll see.
I like the lighting they've got going on in this dark level. It looks nice. It's I try to think of it, the film it reminds me of, Drawing the Blank. It's a little bit of the Total Recall, the redness to it.
Yeah, you're in a mining facility and it's in alert status, so that's why that looks like that. But these things that you're fighting, I think they're like miners that have been irradiated or something, so that effect are...
they've all gone mental and bad.
Yeah. But the whole point of this mission is so you can get crystals which are used to repair your FTL drive or something like that on your spaceship. And I think you can upgrade your spaceship, but I haven't got to that part yet. I think you can, I think you'd be able to create like speeder bikes and things to make it getting around planets easier. But I imagine some planets are harder to get around than others because there's massive mountains on them, you know.
Mm.
But yeah, I like it. I'm definitely going to keep playing.
It looks pretty cool.
It's pretty cool. It's pretty cool.
Yes.
Go on then, give us your next one.
I've been playing Resident Evil 3 again, which I got a while ago. You can download them, all the original Resident Evil titles now, on the PlayStation Network. And they're pretty cheap. I think I got the trilogy, you know, Resident Evil 1, 2 and 3 bundle.
Yeah.
A while ago now. It can't be more than like 12, 15 quid. Which is pretty decent price considering that each game is at least, if you play through each scenario of the first two, you've got at least three, it's like sort of 15 hours-ish of gameplay, depending on how good you are at the games. And the reason I started playing it again is because you may have heard of a YouTube game streamer called Darkside Phil, who is famously terrible at games, but is always streaming loads of different games, and there's a sort of subculture around him of videos called This Is How You Don't Play, and then it'll be a certain game after the title, where right. Someone will edit together his like worst bits and intersplice like little comedy things, like saying, oh, this is what you're supposed to do, Phil, you idiot, or there'll be little comments from people watching the videos saying, how could you not know this? It's stuff like that, just taking the piss out of the guy, basically. It's kind of done in like a good humour kind of thing. I don't know how he feels about it, but it's funny watching somebody really inept at games blame the game for everything that he does wrong as well. Yeah. And so there was one from Resident Evil 3, and it reminded me how much I liked that game, even though of the original Resident Evil games, it is by far the most difficult one. Obviously, it has the nemesis in it chasing you around all the time, which is great for a horror game because it means that, unlike the other Resident Evil games, you actually feel unnerved a lot of the time. Because I can play through the first two now and just basically hardly ever take a hit. I take a hit, it's usually because the old school tank controls are a bit clunky and I miss time a shotgun blast or something, and it's like a silly thing, but I can pretty much get to the end of those games without ever getting hit. In this game, it kicks my ass still, yeah. Actually. I still have to save quite a lot. The other ones, you can do runs where you complete it in under 3 hours and don't save, and you get like an A ranking. I've never done that at Resident Evil 3 because I've never been confident enough at fighting the nemesis to do it. There's always an off chance that he's going to get you. You have, I don't know if you've played that game, but you have a dodge move in it, which you didn't have in the other games. So if you press the aim button at the right moment as an attack's coming, you can do a dodge out of the way. But the timing of it is quite difficult, and it's kind of a little bit inconsistent as well.
Yeah, I have definitely played it, but the original on the PlayStation, probably.
Yeah. I mean, but I'm playing is the original version. It's just a downloaded. You can download it on the network. It's not had an upgrade to graphics or anything. Actually, and it still plays in a... Sorry, go on.
It'll have been PlayStation 2, won't it, this?
No, PlayStation 1.
Really? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
It was good graphics, wasn't it, back then?
Well, obviously, you've got the... If you look at closely at the character models, it's very much PlayStation 1 character models. But that was the whole point, wasn't it, of the... The pre-rendered backgrounds is that they could get much higher fidelity images in the pre-rendered backgrounds.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they were pre-rendered, they wouldn't have to be 3D backgrounds. So they basically had these nice computer-generated images that were still images. You just have 100 or so of them, and that's your game, isn't it? That's the game background. So, yeah, it's a good game. I'm enjoying it, but it is a challenging game to me. Whoever this person is obviously playing in New Game Plus with like all the ridiculous ammo saved up and whatnot. Yeah, it's good. I'm actually probably about two-thirds of the way through it. I was playing it just before we came on here. I had my tea, and I've been playing it for about half an hour before we came on and did this, just because I just like to play through old games every now and then, and this is one of them that I enjoy.
I think I've said it before about Resident Evil games. It's the backtracking that drives me up the wall with it.
Mm.
And it was quite heavy when I remember playing them.
There's a fair bit of backtracking in this one. It really doesn't bother me that much, I'll be honest with you. Because it's the nature of the game, isn't it? It's that sort of thing of where you go into certain types of games that appeal to people and certain types of games that don't.
But I say that, and the next game I'm going to talk about has quite a lot of backtracking in it, so I don't know where I'm coming from.
Yeah. All I know is that... I really, really still, having played this game and thinking about the old school Resident Evil games, I still really hope that they get the Resident Evil 2 remake right. It's my favourite game in the series, Resident Evil 2, even though I'll just be talking about this one. And I really want them to not do it shit. I want them to do it properly.
Yeah.
Like the original Resident Evil remake was superb, and I want it to be that level of quality again.
Why does she have to be dressed like that? It's just...
It is silly. I think
she a nightclub in a nightclub or something?
No, the game literally starts where like the zombie outbreak happens, and this is set. The game is set slightly before and then slightly after Resident Evil 2, because there's a time skip at a certain point where she gets injured and then has to recover, and then it skips to after Resident Evil 2. But this starts before. So Resident Evil 2, the zombie outbreak has happened, and Leon and Claire get to the city, and they're like, "Where's everybody? Oh no, zombies!" Whereas in this game, it's just started kicking off. So the idea is that Jill wasn't at work or anything. She was just like at home, and suddenly zombie apocalypse happened in her city and she had to get out.
Right.
And then they sent this nemesis after her and the other STARS members, basically. So the idea is that she's just wearing her normal clothes. It is still the kind of outfit that you wouldn't necessarily expect a Special Forces police officer woman to wear, even on their downtime, necessarily.
Well, just look at that skirt. I mean, I was actually looking at the top, but the skirt's even more inappropriate, isn't it? But I'm sure this has been discussed to death, you know, in the past.
Yeah, it has. It has. Whatever. Jill Valentine is... It's not like there's any good characterization in Resident Evil, but Jill Valentine is a badass in the Resident Evil, like, world. She can kick the shit out of the nemesis wearing a boob tube and a mini skirt. That's how hard she is. There you go. Blast those zombies, girl. So, yeah. Good, really good games. I really love those old Resident Evil games. And third one is the hardest one out of all of them, though.
The one that you're playing then is basically what we're looking at here, even though this is the original.
This is the beginning of the game, but this person playing it here is clearly playing like a carried over save where they've got all the big weapons and stuff. Because obviously, like most Resident Evil games, you start out with 15 bullets in your pistol and a combat knife.
Yeah.
It's the traditional way you start. So this person's obviously started with all the assault rifle and the magnum and everything else, all the ridiculous shit. They've got two shotguns now, for example. Anyway, that's about it. Everybody who's played it already knows everything about that game, but I've just been playing through it again because I like it.
Yeah, so I don't think it's... I mean, I've tried to play four... What was it? The one in Africa?
Resident Evil 4. Or Resident Evil 5 in Africa.
Yeah.
Resident Evil 4 is the one that's set in Spain, but they call it this part of Europe, even though it's blatantly Spain. And you play as Leon Kennedy with the floppy hair.
I've played that before, but I wasn't keen. 5, I've been playing recently. Is it 5? I don't know.
5 is not so good.
It's the one where you're playing as somebody and you go and kill zombies.
That one,
yeah. It's just the type of game, the slow movement that usually you have tank controls in it, and it's just a little bit... Not for me. But I know, you know, the Resident Evil games are well loved, and I'm not going to start slagging them off.
But they're fucking shit.
Fucking shots. Okay, I'm going to run through two of the ones I've quickly played. XCOM 2, I've actually completed that now. I put 56 hours into it and completed it without losing a single soldier. 56 hours is probably, I'd say about 50 of those hours was reloading saves, probably.
Is that so you didn't lose any soldiers?
Yeah, absolutely, so I didn't lose any soldiers. I'm a save scummer, so what? I enjoy doing that and thoroughly enjoyed that game. It was brilliant.
Does that, if you had to save soldiers at the end that you had at the start, does that mean that they were like crazy high level by the time you got to the end of the game?
Yeah, they were all like major. I think that's the highest rank you can get, major or colonel. I think Colonel's higher. I think Colonel was the max rank you can get.
I think in real life Colonel's higher, but I don't know about the game.
No, it's based on the US military. But US military is different from UK. Major's different. Oh God, I'm not sure. You know which way it is. Anyway, it doesn't matter. All of my soldiers were the highest. I had one Psy operative, so I had one soldier that had basically every single Psy skill that you could possibly get, and I had nearly all of the highest... No, I had all the highest armor, all the highest weapons, but it didn't seem... The game didn't seem like it had as much in it as the previous game in terms of the content of the weapons and the content of the missions. Even though I didn't get bored of it, it felt like it was easier to get the research done. I don't know, but they have refined quite a lot of the processes in the game as well, so I don't know what...
When you say refined, is that one of those... But they've sort of slimmed down some of the busy work and done it more automatically for you.
Well, yes and no. You still have to research items, but you don't have to... there's some repeatable research as well in there. So you'll get data pads occasionally, or you'll get intel from just missions generally, and you'll have to use that. You can research that intel in order to get some... research that those data pads in order to get some intel, and intel is used to buy certain soldiers and skills and speed things up from the main base. I liked the refinements. Generally, the game is better than the original, but it did feel a bit simpler. I don't know. I didn't really feel under duress, but then again, I was cheating. I was safe scumming all the way through it, so...
Did you do that with the previous one?
Yeah, I always have done. But the previous one, even then, it felt like... It felt really difficult to do some of the missions, but I don't know. Maybe because I've got a faster computer now and I can save, reload saves quicker. It didn't feel as bad. I don't know. I don't know what it was. But yeah, completed that, and you know, I might go back to it if they'd release some good DLC, or I didn't really experience any bugs or game-breaking issues. There's a few little things that were a problem, but nothing that stopped me from enjoying it. Definitely worth the money I paid for it. I thoroughly enjoyed XCOM 2.
56 hours is a good innings for a game as well.
Well, I mean, you know, usually good games I'm playing for 100 plus hours, but...
Depends on the game. Not all games are 100 plus. I mean, you went through to the end and put 56 hours in and enjoyed it. It's like
absolutely. Got a good value. I mean, I would have kept playing it, but I mean, I actually completed it just before I went away for work recently. So it was about 2.5 weeks ago. So I spent maybe a week and a half playing it fairly constantly, and it was before I was working as well, so I had time during the day. So I ploughed as much as I could into it every night, given it wasn't constant, you know. And yeah, I got a good few weeks out of playing it. I think it was good.
Yeah.
So have you played anything else then?
I haven't. Those are the only two, seriously, that I've played since we last did the stream. Obviously, I've spent quite a bit of time on and off with The Witness, and I've been playing Resident Evil for the past couple of days, but I went through a big, like, week and a half stretch where I didn't touch a game, because to do with what I was doing outside of work and working a lot, it just wasn't convenient. I didn't have the time. I don't like to sit down and play for half an hour. I want to get, like, a session's got to be at least an hour for me.
I'm exactly
like
the same.
I've had a go. If I can't get an hour out of it, I don't see the point in turning it on.
For me, it has to be a night. If I'm playing a game, I have to I have to finish everything for the day, and then the rest of the night. Like last night, I got a new Wii U game. It was my birthday last week, and I got a voucher, and I got another Wii U game as well, which I said I'm going to talk about in a bit. But I used the voucher to get some money off Super Mario 3D World, which I've had my eyes on for a while. Oh, so it's the latest 3D Super Mario. And
but it's not 3D as in you. It's not like Mario 64 3D. It's 3D models, but it's still a 2D platformer, right? Right?
Nope, absolutely not. No. Oh. You're thinking of New Super Mario Brothers.
Maybe I am. Yeah.
New Super Mario Brothers is one I've been playing a while back. Yeah, I have got that for the Wii U as well, and I've completed that, and that is the 3D models in a 2D world.
Okay.
But Super Mario 3D World is basically Super Mario 64 for the new generation, Super Mario Galaxy, you know, that kind of thing. And I absolutely adored Galaxies 1 and 2 and Super Mario 64, so I was being quite looking forward to this. But as with all console games, it was £40 minimum anywhere you could buy it. 50, 60 quid generally is how much you pay for console games, AAA games anyway. And I kind of resent paying that for them kind of games. So,
and Nintendo games don't go down in value that quickly as well.
No, it's been out for a while, Super Mario 3D World, but I've had my eye on it and it hasn't really went down. But anyway, I've got it. I haven't played it yet. I wanted to talk about that a bit today, but I haven't played it. But last night, as I said, I'd finished all the stuff that I needed to do. I had some paperwork that I needed to do and got all out of the way. And then I wanted to play Super Mario 3D World. Oh, sorry. And then my wife said, "Do you want to play it downstairs?" Because she doesn't mind watching. And I was just like, "Oh, I've only got like an hour. No. I can't. I'm not. No, I'd rather just chill out for the rest of the night, you know," which is weird for someone who loves playing games as much. But so yeah, if I can't start at like 5 or 6 o'clock when I finish work and zonk for the day, you know, for the night, I don't play games.
I know the feeling. I like to get a good. I like to feel like I've had a good old go. You know, I don't want to play for like 20 minutes and then stop. It's shit.
Hmm. So Wednesday was my birthday last week. So Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night, all day Saturday and all day Sunday, I've been playing the other game that I got, the other Wii U game, which is Zelda Twilight Princess HD for the Wii U.
Yes.
Which only just came out, and my wife got it for me. I've already got it for the Wii, the normal Wii. My wife got it for me, and I looked at it and I thought, when I opened it, she always worries that she's going to get me an awful present, something that I don't like, because I'm really quite a critical person when it comes to presents. I'm like, if it's not useful for me, don't get me a present. Just forget about it.
Yeah, but it's Zelda.
But Zelda, and anyway, she got it, and it came with a Link Midna amiibo. Have you played Twilight Princess?
Yeah, you got it on the Wii, and I completed your version of it twice. I liked it that much.
Twice? Played through
twice? I've completed that game twice, yeah.
So this is the HD version, and I've got to say it looks awesome. It's very nice seeing a HD version of Zelda. It's got no frame rate issues. It's got no bugs of any sort that I've come across yet. It's lovely animations. Lovely. I mean, it's not like proper realistic looking HD, but for a game that was released on the GameCube, this looks brilliant, you know?
Yeah.
Now, here's an interesting fact. Have you played it on anything but the Wii?
No, I only played it on the Wii.
So I've only played it on the Wii as well, previous to playing it on this. And when I started this, I had an option of playing it via like normal mode or
Hero mode.
Say again.
Or I was about to say, with motion controls, but the Wii U doesn't have the same motion controls as the Wii, does it?
You can play it either with the Wii U pad, which has got the screen on it, which is, again, I'll talk about that in a minute, but you can also play it with the Wii U Classic controller, which is just basically an Xbox controller type thing. And but I played it on Hero mode originally, and Hero mode means that you take four times as much damage, and you have... hearts don't drop. You know, when you break a bush or something, you get hearts it. So I played it, and I played about 2 hours of it, maybe 2.5 hours. And the night that I finished playing it, I think it maybe the second night, I forgot to save it, and I hadn't done maybe about 30 minutes of the game, and I thought, oh, fucking hell, I've got to do that 30 minutes again. I know exactly what I'm doing, so it's going to take me 10 minutes to do it, but still, and I'll skip past all the cutscenes, but still, I'm not really enjoying Hero mode. It's not doing much for me, if you know what I mean. It was extremely difficult. Right, so I started the normal mode, and this is where the interesting fact comes in. Started the normal mode, and the game world was flipped. Like, totally the opposite direction. So, you know, when you come out of Link's house at the beginning of the game, if you can remember... Mm-hmm. You've got the dummy on the right hand side, and you've got the two entrances on the left hand side. You've got one that goes off to the Farron Woods and one that goes off to the Auden Village.
Yeah, I don't remember it that well, but I'll take your word for it.
If you played it, you would. So yeah. The second time I started the game in normal mode, I looked at it and I was like, there's something wrong here. I've just been playing it anyway, so my brain had got used to this way around. I was like, what the hell's going on here? So I googled it and I was like, actually, I restarted the game again to see if it was a bug that happened. I don't know. And Auden Village was completely the wrong way around when I went into that. The whole of the Farron Woods was the wrong way. It's like the whole world was flipped. And I was like, what the fuck is going on here? And I googled it, and apparently it's by design what they've done. The story is they originally released Zelda Twilight Princess on the Wii, but it was meant to be a GameCube release.
Yes.
They released it on the Wii originally, and because during testing, there's lots of like iterations of testing, but during testing, somebody high up in Nintendo said, I don't like the fact that now we're playing it on the Wii, I'm right-handed, and I'm swishing with my right hand.
I knew that was coming.
But Link is left-handed.
He is.
Because they didn't have the time to basically reanimate Link the other way around, they just flipped the entire world for the Wii release. The GameCube release apparently is, because the GameCube release came out a month after the Wii release, apparently the GameCube release has the original world. So what they've done in this game, in the HD version, is Hero mode is the Wii release essentially, and normal mode is the GameCube release. So I'm now playing the game again. I mean, although I haven't played it for quite some years, it's great to play it again anyway. It's almost like I'm playing a new game, because I'm having to relearn, even though it's a fairly simple layout, I'm having to relearn where everything is, and it's just weird. Like, when you go into the ranch area where you do the training in Auden Village, it's like, instead of the ranch building being on the left when you walk in, it's on the right, and the big area's on the left, and it's like, it's just totally confusing.
That's really strange, though.
It's really strange, but it's also really, really interesting that they did it, and something that I just did not know about Zelda games.
But the Hero mode, the Wii version wasn't that difficult either, though. So I guess in Hero mode, it's the flipped Wii version plus the difficulty stuff that you were talking about.
Yeah, I'm not even sure if Wii had an option for difficulty. I don't think it did.
I don't think it did. I think you just played it. Because normally on Zelda, there's no difficulty. You just play. There's just one difficulty, right? Normally.
Yeah, I mean, from my recollection, I can't remember it having a different difficulty.
And it wasn't that difficult, I mean, either. In terms of, there's some of the stuff, like, some of the challenges were difficult, but I never really died in combat that much in it, I don't think.
Yeah, I mean, once I got into the controls on this, I actually remember playing it on the Wii and getting quite used to the fact that you'd swing your nunchuck to do to do the spinning thing. And the controls are quite different, and you have to get your head around buttons instead of, you know, I played Skyward Sword as well after that. So the last two big Zelda games I've played on the Wii, and I've played with the sword swishing and, you know, the like battering people with your shield with the left hand nunchuck and stuff. And it's just nothing like that at all. So you have to get used to the new control system. But yeah, I thought it was really interesting that, and it to me it makes the game feel new, even newer than it already does.
It's definitely interesting. I remember because Link in, even I think since the first Zelda, if you could even tell in that game, but I believe that Link has always been left-handed, apart from when they started to do motion control and they realised that most people aren't. Now you think the obvious thing would be to give you the choice, because if you are a left-handed person and you buy the game, that means that all the lefties in the world, people like Lou, he wouldn't play it anyway because he's not into Nintendo, but would be like, oh, you know, this game's not accommodating me. I think, I'm not sure if in Skyward Sword you can pick.
I don't know. They might have, I think they probably thought of it in the Skyward Sword, and because we're right-handed, we probably never even thought about it, you know, it just...
I know, I've never, that's one of the big Zelda games I've never played, never have played Skyward Sword, no. It's, I never bought a Wii, so I never played it.
It's not as good as Twilight Princess, but, I mean, it got worse reviews, but I still really enjoyed it as a Zelda fan. But this, I mean, I actually forgot how good the Twilight Princess is. It's extremely... Oh, and there's a few other cool additions. When you can finally transform into a wolf at will, on the Wii U gamepad, there's a button to do it, so you don't have to keep calling Midna, which is so cool. Awesome. I mean, it's only a few milliseconds because it's quite quick, but it makes a big difference.
That makes a difference to me, that kind of stuff.
And also being able to swap your items. So you've got your Y, X, and B to right trigger, or whatever they call it, ZR, or whatever they call it. ZR?
Yeah. I don't know. I've not played
There's two of them anyway on the Wii U, and they're you get to swap those out in real time. So, but you can pause it if you want. So, if you're in the middle of a battle and you need to pause it, you can pause it and swap things out. But it's also really handy to do that to be able to drag and drop within the Wii U screen, whatever it's called, the Wii U gamepad. I actually really like the Wii U gamepad. I didn't think I would. And I'm amazed it's not been as popular as it should have been, you know? The Wii U, I mean.
Yeah, I don't know if it's to do with the way they marketed it or the fact that it... No, it's a strange one, isn't it, really?
It's a really nice console, though, to use. And the control system, I really like the pad. I really like the second screen interaction. And one of the other beautiful things is, on this game again, you can actually play like you could on... one of the Mario, Super Mario, new Super Mario. Sorry, you can play it on the screen while the TV's been in use.
Yeah, like you can import the whole game to the gamepad.
And it's just literally a case of pressing minus, I think, on the gamepad, and it instantly switches. It's playing on the Wii, but it's, you know, your screen is on the pad, and the screen lasts about the pad lasts on charge while you're playing for about 3 or 4 hours, which is pretty good. And then you can just plug it in after that.
Well, interesting thing about the Wii U is that the Wii U, I know it's had a couple of Mario games, but it hasn't had a big main canon Zelda game on it. They've done an HD version of Wind Waker and now this, but they haven't done the new Zelda game has not come out on the Wii U, and it's looking like it's not going to.
No.
So I'm wondering about the Wii U. Is it a case of it hasn't, apart from keeping up with Mario, it's not had the big hitters, it's not gone for the big, here's the new Metroid, here's the new, they've had a Smash Brothers game, right? But
yeah,
I don't know if they've just not had the same big new releases that seem like a leap forward, the way that getting my games mixed up. This game was originally quite a leap forward for a Zelda game because it was like, yeah, it's an update of Ocarina of Time with motion controls. Don't you want to buy this console now? You know that kind of thing? And the same with Mario Galaxy. It's a new 3D Mario game with motion controls. Get this console. There's not really been anything that's sort of pushed their technology that they can say, this is our big flagship thing. I don't not that I can think of him, unless you can correct me, like, if one of the Mario games like that.
There's two main Mario releases on this, Super Mario 3D World, which I haven't played yet, so I can't comment on. And I haven't read any reviews, so I don't know if it's been received well or not. And this new Super Mario Brothers 2, which is basically just Super Mario Brothers 1, which was on the Wii. That was on the Wii. You're right, there hasn't been, but this is also a HD console, so it has had some releases, such as some of the other AAA releases from other developers.
Yeah,
I can't think off the top of my head what they are, but the issue with that, for example, Far Cry 4, I think, has come out on it.
Yeah, which is fine, but the issue you have with that is that when they've not been, this is the issue the GameCube had as well, when they've not been doing the other game, they haven't done any of the other Far Cry games up to this point, so jumping in at Far Cry 4, you're not, somebody like me, who maybe I didn't want to get Far Cry 4, well, I played the other one on my PlayStation, I could have got Far Cry 2 on my PlayStation as well, and I can get Far Cry 4 and Primal and Blood Dragon on there too. So why would I then go and get a Wii, a Nintendo console, to play Far Cry? And that kind of goes for the other ones. Nintendo have not generally been very good at their third-party AAA. They've never had a Call of Duty, have they? They've never had a FIFA game on there. Do you know that kind of stuff that shifts those other consoles? They've never been part of that market. And
even if they do now, yeah, they've never been in it.
They've not cultivated that market. They've not made a fan base out of it. They've made a fan base out of their own IPs, which they've got a lot of, and that's why you probably got one. It's because you like Zelda and Mario and stuff like that.
Well, I actually got one as a surprise from my wife. I wasn't planning on buying one. I'm glad I have got it now because of the games I've played. I've enjoyed the Nintendo games, and I always wanted to get one, but I was going to wait for a while, you know, until I went down that route. I was going to wait until the new Zelda game came out, actually. And if it didn't, I was going to get the next console. Simple as
that. That's kind of what I've been thinking. If the new Zelda game's as good as it looks, I might have to get the new Nintendo console, whatever it is, when it eventually appears.
Yeah. I mean, I suppose the benefit of it is the main benefit is the family-orientated aspect of Nintendo consoles and the fact that it's quite a bit cheaper than the other consoles on the market. That's a reason to go for it, and it's all HD now, so there shouldn't be any real reason not to go for it.
Yeah.
But yeah, anyway, back to the Twilight Princess. I'm really glad I got it. I'm really glad Cell bought it for me, and I'm thoroughly enjoying it. God knows, I think I'm about 20 hours into it so far, and I only got it on Wednesday. So, you know, it's...
It's a big game as well. I remember there's a lot in it. I mean, if you want to do all the side stuff, the extra challenges, there's loads of like challenge things you can do as well, aren't there?
There's like a
hookshot challenge in the town, isn't there?
Yeah, I haven't got a second like hookshot yet, so I can't do that.
And there's that rafting thing you did before. There's a challenge version of that too, isn't there?
There's a hell of a lot in it.
Yeah, I like all that stuff though.
Yeah, and that's what makes Zelda games. You know, they've set, I suppose, they've set the marker for a lot of other RPGs, even though other RPGs have went further and done things more realistically. Zelda's got its tropes. Zelda's got its... There's always a monkey in a Zelda game. There's always there's always three dungeons that you have to overcome before some event happens, and then the three things that you got from that dungeon get taken off you, and then you have to go and get that thing, and then you have to maybe do another seven dungeons in order to finish off the game, and then there's a final boss battle. But
there's always a chicken. If you mess with that chicken too much, all the chickens will come and fuck you up.
Although that doesn't happen in this game, because I was trying to show Sal that. I mind you, I tried it with a wooden sword, so it might have been different, but what happens is you can control the chickens. If you hit them enough, you can control the chicken, because I hit him loads and then he just stood still and I was like, what's going on here? And I did it again, and then I accidentally moved the control pad and I realized I could control the control the chicken. I'm not sure what the benefit of that is, I have to be honest with you.
Just for shits and giggles. Maybe you can get secret items doing that way.
Maybe, yeah.
Like they can fly up and grab a heart piece or something.
Yeah, it is the weirdest character in any Nintendo game ever as well.
Yeah.
Agatha.
Even weirder than Tinkle.
Tingle.
Tingle's the little green guy who first is in Majora's Mask, I think.
I've not seen it. I've not played Majora's Mask.
Or I think he's in the Wind Waker as well. A little dude in a green outfit and a moustache. And he's like, oh, tingle, tingle, whoa. Like the text will say it. And he does a little spin and goes, whoa. Like he's really, look him up later. Like you probably have seen him.
Probably.
Very strange.
Well, the two you mentioned there, I played Wind Waker quite a lot, but I didn't complete Wind Waker. It's one of the few ones I haven't. Yeah, I said I'm liking it, and I think I'll definitely be continuing. But I do want to try my new Super Mario game at some point soon too.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
Yeah, very good, very good. Okay, so I think that's it for games, isn't it? I think we've exhausted it now.
Yeah, pretty much.
So let's move on to gaming news. I said I haven't been around for the last few weeks. I haven't really been paying much attention to gaming news. So hopefully, Sam, you can lead this, or at least the parts that you've been having a look at.
Yeah, there's the things that I've looked at here. The point I'm going to start with is the PlayStation, Sony, PlayStation VR has been given a release window. I believe it's October, so they've not set a certain date yet. I'm just trying to pull up the article now, but there's been a price set, and I believe I'll have to double check when the article eventually loads on my slow laptop. It's $399, which is much cheaper than the Oculus has been sold at.
Yeah, but it's still expensive. That £400.
It's dollars, so it won't be £400 when it comes out. No, it's not loading properly.
I'm looking.
Sorry, I've opened up the one I put in there. Anyway,
we've got a spec, which is the resolution is 920 times. I don't understand what this spec means, but 920 times RGB times 1080, which is in brackets 960 times RGB times 1080 per eye. What?
Yeah.
I don't know what that means. What's the resolution? Just tell us. 120 hertz or 90 hertz. Not sure why there are those two different refresh rates again. 360 degree tracking with 9 LEDs, approximately 100 degree FOV, I'm imagining. Yeah, FOV. And latency is less than 18 milliseconds. It's not too bad, but there are monitors faster than that as well. DualShock and PS4 Move controllers, 5.7 inch OLED screen.
And you will need to buy the camera to go with it as well, I believe.
That's not included in that $500. $400.
I'm not sure if it's if they're going to do it as like a bundle. There's also a thing saying that on the pre-orders for it on Amazon were all sold out within like minutes of it being announced.
Fans will also need the PlayStation camera, which will be sold separately for $60.
Yeah. So it adds a bit more onto the price as well, because you're going to need it, so you can't get the thing, you can't buy the VR kit.
What a load of shit. As confirmed, Sony UK on Twitter, in order for the PSVR to work in its entirety, fans will also need the PlayStation camera. What? Don't sell me a product if I can't use it.
Yeah, I don't really get what they mean by it in its entirety. I mean, it's a headset. What's the camera for? If you're still using the normal controller to interact with the game, I don't know. It could be to do with maybe if you're using the Move controller at the same time, that's the difference.
Maybe if you need that. That makes sense, but if you've got a Move, you usually got a camera anyway.
Yeah, I guess so.
I mean, I've got a Move for my PS3. Would that work with a PS4?
Probably not. I wouldn't be surprised if it doesn't. You know what they're like with these things? They don't want you to use the old stuff on the new stuff.
Whereas Nintendo are quite backward compatible friendly, because the Wii, all of the Wii components, all of the peripherals, they all work on the Wii U, and you can play Wii games on the Wii U. I'm not sure about GameCube games. I haven't tried them.
You could plug GameCube controllers into your Wii, couldn't you, and stuff like that. So they.
Oh yeah, you could.
They've always been pretty good at supporting that, and you could plug GameCube discs, I think, into your Wii as well. You could play them. I think
that's what makes me think maybe GameCube discs will work on the Wii U, because even though it's emulated, the Wii is emulated on the Wii U, that means that they should have, because the GameCube was basically the same thing and that wasn't emulated on the Wii, so hopefully you can be able to play it. I haven't tried though.
Yeah.
I think I've got the Wind Waker and I do want to try playing it at some point again. Although Wind Waker HD apparently has things like fast travel in it, which makes the laborious task of going over the seas easier.
Apparently, yeah, apparently that really helps cut down, especially at the end of the game when you've got to find all the Triforce like pieces, the shop of shards that are all scattered around the ridiculously massive ocean. Yeah.
£349 in the UK.
Okay. So that's still a pretty it's more than I'm willing to pay, let's put it that way.
I just don't think I want to bother.
I'm not that interested. If it really comes out and it really is the next thing and it's like really kicking off, then I guess I'll see if it comes down in price and give it a go. But at the moment, it's not grabbing me that hard.
I think I'll probably just end up with a PC headset more than anything. I don't think I'll bother with consoles because I don't play consoles enough these days to warrant paying that much. Even though I'm a collector and I really want to, sensibility inside me as I'm getting older makes me think that £400 can go towards my mortgage, you know?
So there's that. That's probably the sort of one of the most interesting things I've come across. The second sort of biggest one, an interesting one, again, it's a bit vague. It's more about their sort of what they're planning to do. Microsoft is going to sort of have open networks for cross-platform play. Now, they've obviously said, I think, between PC and other things is going to be generally possible, but I think they sort of intoned that it's going to be across with the PlayStation as well. Now, I don't really know how that's going to work with their servers and stuff, but there'll be a way for them to do it. And the fact that they're opening up to it is something that we've talked about before, isn't it? Now, obviously, with the PC thing, I believe was it Steve shared a while ago a news article about people doing that on some sort of first-person shooter, and predictably the PC players trounced the console players.
Even the mediocre or low-end PC players.
Now, I think, let's say if you were playing Street Fighter V on your PC on a console, probably not that much of a difference in the interface quality. If you're good at doing it on the controller, you're probably okay, unless you really have to get a joystick and you're like hardcore fighter gamer, which you're going to have for your PC anyway. If you're that hardcore, that input's going to be the same. So yeah, for like first person shooters and things like that, it probably will.
It'll
be interesting.
Just reading the article, I mean, Microsoft are very much in the development arena, stuff that I'm looking into, that I work with. They're very much moving to like an open source type platform, so it's very collaborative and it's very accepting of communities and different like operating systems, so Windows and Linux and Unix and Mac stuff all kind of working together. I think their philosophy as a company is changing quite a lot recently. I know the problem is with Xbox One is its sales are miles behind PlayStation 4, like ridiculously slow. So this could be them trying to, I don't know, get more sales, but it could also go the other way for them and make them get less sales if it's all cross-platform. I don't know.
I just thought it was interesting. Somebody actually mentioned it to me at work, somebody who'd heard it, and I was like, oh, that's interesting. So just before we came on, I looked it up because I'd forgotten about it and then remembered. As I say, I don't think there are really any details about how they're going to make it work yet. But it's certainly an interesting development, isn't it?
It's not difficult to... Well, I say it's not difficult. I think there are some challenges, but generally with the way that software is going these days, everything is... You'll have heard the term cloud before, probably. Everything will be hosted in clouds. Everything will be in one central place where, in a distributed place where everything is accessed via simple API calls. That just basically means that everything speaks the same language. And that means that PlayStation and Xbox and PC and we can all connect to the same place and get the same data and do the same, you know, network interactions, just with a different kind of front end. And that's probably where they're going to go with this kind of thing, I imagine.
Yeah.
It's interesting. And I for one, wouldn't mind seeing that, I have to be honest. It'd be really nice for you and I to play together. And I'm on my platform of choice. You're on your platform of choice, you know?
Yeah, I'd be curious to see how that all works out, really.
Yeah, I mean, it's a long road, no matter how it works out. It's you know, indie developers will have to catch up with that as well, because there'll be more effort involved in that kind of thing.
But it will open up their doors to sell more units for certain games, you know?
Yeah.
Like, if, for example, that game you were talking about, something like Nidhogg, or... that was that Beastmasters one you talked about? Beastmasters is a cartoon, I think. Gang Beasts, if you could have that, like, again, somebody playing on a PC, somebody playing on an Xbox, yeah, I mean, that just opens up more avenues, doesn't it, for people to interact and play together online, which, for the consumer in the long run, can only really be a good thing.
Yeah, I mean, for the
if it works.
Consumers don't care as long as it's fair. And, you know, I don't think, as you said, there's always going to be some games where PC platform has more advantages because of the way it plays. But there's nothing to say that you couldn't plug a keyboard and a mouse into a PlayStation 4 if you really want to and play that way, as long as the game supports it and the platform supports it.
Yeah, I think you can do that, actually.
But if you wanted to, that's whether or not console gamers would want to do that is another thing. I know you probably wouldn't.
I'm so inexperienced at that way of controlling that I would die. I would be worse because I'm so not used to the WSD mouse control aiming thing in general. I'd be terrible at it. And it would probably take me a while to get good. I didn't start when I was a kid like you probably did.
Yeah, well, it's just what you get used to, isn't it? I'm awful with a control pad. I'm awful playing on mouse and keyboard these days, for God's sake. All I do is play single player games. I don't really go online and challenge myself in that way anymore these days. Okay, what have we got? Oh, yes, a couple of weeks ago, Super Hot was released, which is another indie game that's been touted and kind of in the spotlight for a while. Do you know anything about it?
I do, actually. I saw somebody doing a playthrough of it, not the original one, but there was somebody had like an early access version of it a while ago.
Yeah.
And I thought it's really quite an interesting and looks like a pretty good fun game, actually.
Apparently
it's quite short.
Oh, is it? Right. I played the demo a while ago. I think it was a demo or something like that. It was a tech release of some sort. But at the time, it was an interesting concept, but the demo was tiny. You know, there wasn't much to it, so... I'm not sure I'm going to get much more out of a full game.
Yeah, I like the concept of it, though, because for those that don't know, I believe I'm right in saying that it's a first-person perspective game, ostensibly a shooter, where time only moves if you move. So if you stand still, it's still. But then once you start to take action, the time starts moving then. So it means that you can prepare to take shots and do certain things, but as soon as you start to take those actions... time in the game starts moving as well. So as you can see, there's a lot of speeding up and slowing down in the game footage because of that fact. I think that's about right, what I just said.
Yeah,
if I'm wrong.
It's different from other first-person shooters in the fact that, yeah, that things, time speeds up and slows down, but it's also extremely difficult to not strategize and plan your move better than you would expect. A lot of effort is put into FPS games to make it so enemies don't hit you, if that makes sense. So if an enemy shoots you, it's easy for us as programmers to calculate where that bullet should hit and make it hit that point. But it's more difficult for us to go give it some variation and give it a chance of not hitting, or it having a chance to ricochet, or having a chance to vary, you know, vary the path that it takes. But I think this game, from what I can tell, doesn't do that. I think it's got its its bullets are precise, so that's what makes it difficult as well. When I was playing the demo, if someone shoots you and you don't make an immediate decision to move out of the way, you're gonna die. I know it took me a long time to get to that point. Sorry, then I'm trying to watch the demo because this is slightly new from what I was playing before.
Okay,
it looks interesting. I mean, yeah. I think I'll give it a go.
I think it's a PC only thing, but I wouldn't mind. If it was on console, I'd be well up for giving it a crack. It looks like it'd just be, even if it's just not that much to it, just as an idea, I think it'd be quite good fun.
It's different. Definitely worth a go if you get a chance to have a go of it.
Yeah, if I do, I will, basically.
Another piece of news that is at least relevant to me anyway, because I quite enjoyed the first one. Dead Island 2 got cancelled a while ago. I don't know if you remember me saying.
Yeah, I remember.
But it's got another developer. Don't know who it is off the top of my head. I didn't write that down, but... my wife, she's involved in all of the zombie stuff, zombie pages and news sites and stuff. So she saw that it's got a new developer and she's looking forward to that now. So I'll probably get that when it comes out. I think it's the one that's based in California, isn't it? And
what do you mean, the second one?
Yeah, the second one I think is based in California and in LA, Hollywood type thing.
What an island. Imagine. But didn't the original developer of Dead Island do Dying Light, which was basically a bigger version of the Dead Island concept?
I thought that was the case, but I think they were just maybe the publisher or something like that. I think Techland were the developers of that, but I don't think they were the developers of Dead Island. I'm not sure. Maybe it was original developers that have moved into another company. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I remember Dying Light looking quite interesting when it first was being released, but apparently it's nothing that interesting, this game. Like, if it's not connected to Dead Island, then I suppose it's not relevant conversation.
No. Okay, so any other news before we move on? So we've got Bloodborne.
There was an odd little thing just about a Bloodborne card game, which apparently is not going to be based on the main story as such, as it is going to be based on what is called the Chalice Dungeons in Bloodborne. And what they are is they're basically challenge dungeons that you unlock a key item that can get you into the Chalice Dungeon. And there's an overworld hub in Bloodborne, much like there was in the first Demon's Souls, and you go there to open up different parts of the game or to create shortcuts to different parts of the game as well. And you can access these chalice dungeons by putting a certain chalice on a certain gravestone. Then you activate that gravestone, it takes you to a dungeon and you fight through basically challenge rooms and bosses to get stuff. Like, you can get weapons and you can get XP and you can get whatever. So apparently the card game is going to be loosely based around that concept. Now, how it's going to work out, I don't know, but it's just an interesting tie-in thing that I wasn't quite expecting, and it just popped up in the news and I thought, it's worth a mention at least.
Fair enough. I mean, card games always appeal to me, but I never really have enough time or friends to play them.
I don't know how that would work. I'd have to see once it's released and see how it works to really get a handle on it, but yeah, it's an official thing, so the From Software obviously actually licensed someone to do it, which is quite cool. And there was another stupid thing as well that I was going to paste, but I couldn't find the article again. Apparently, they're making a Resident Evil musical in Japan.
What?
Stage musical. I got nothing. The only thing I can say about that is that it can't be any worse than the films. So it's got that going for it.
You know, I know what, Sel quite likes the films. She doesn't rave about them or anything, but she quite likes them.
I don't. I've seen the first two, and she's interested because as a zombie fan, they're not good zombie films, and as a Resident Evil fan, they're not good Resident Evil films. So I don't really know where the enjoyment comes from for that. But that's just me, I guess.
Fair enough. I don't really have an opinion. I think I've seen maybe 5 minutes of the first one, maybe if that. Anyway, so I think we're done for the week. I promise that we'll be putting a bit more effort into these and trying to get together a bit more. My madness has finished now, at least. I don't know if you and Steve's madness is slowing down at all. So
who's to say? I don't know.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see as we go. But anyway, thank you very much for those who have watched. There has been a few people popping in and out of chat, but generally it's been quite quiet today. Spread the word. Hopefully we'll be back next Wednesday, and we'll do our best anyway. What is confusing me in chat, hence why I keep slowing down. I think he's taking a piss out of my accent this time. But anyway, hello Wut, and goodbye Wut. Thank you very much for watching, everybody, and we shall see you next time.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.